We're going to talk to author Barry Riddles. He is the author of Bailout Nation, How Greedy and Easy Money Corrupted Wall Street and Shook the World Economy. Barry, welcome to the Young Turks.
Thanks for having me.
We appreciate your time. All right, I want to start with point number three here on a list I have, which is you say that the CEOs of the biggest 15 investment banks, mortgage firms, and commercial banks retired from the firms they helped to ruin and took home over $1.5 billion in compensation. Now, that's an unbelievable number. First, you know what? How did they do it? Let's talk about that.
Well, it goes back quite a good couple of years, and Roger Lowenstein's book, Origins of the Crash, written after the 2000 crash, not the 2008 crash, pretty much talked about a real change in corporate governance. You know, in theory, a corporation is a democracy, and their shareholders are like voters, and they vote for a board of directors, and that board of directors is supposed to operate on behalf of the shareholders. But what ends up happening is the way the rules are structured, it's not a true democracy. The deck is very much stacked. And in some companies, and it's not just finance companies, but it's a lot of other firms, the CEO manages to put a lot of his golf buddies and other cronies, in the book I call it Crony Capitalism, on the board. They basically vote absurd packages for him, and it's typically him, 98% of the time it's a him. Then they go out, in order to justify this, they hire this other group of weasels called compensation consultants, and these people are, you know, absolutely corrupt, lying weasels who just take a big check to say, yes, this is standard in the industry. If you don't pay this guy, your competition's going to grab him. You got to give him all this money. And the numbers are absurd. So when you see Robert Nardelli, who drove Home Depot into a negative state versus Lowe's, he left with $400 million. Even some of the guys at Lehman Brothers and Bear Stearns, Dick Fuld cashed out $1 billion, although a good chunk of that he gave back. I think he's going to have to scrape by with a mere $450 million. And you know, how could you really live on that sort of budget?
It's just a quick aside there before we move on to the structural problem. Why or how did he give it back?
Well, he gave it back because he was sitting in a lot of exercise stock that went to zero. So it wasn't that he turned around and said to the shareholders, hey, I did a lousy job. Here's some of your money back. I hope, I makes it a little better. This was, with a guy like Dick Fuld, he was a lifer. He was with the company for decades. And even though he wasn't a particularly good CEO and it was took a lot of risk and didn't listen to his staff and allowed the firm to become way over leveraged and way too exposed to mortgages, they used to say he bled Lehman green. I think he believed he was doing what was best for the company, despite the fact that he helped drive it right over the cliff. And so he had exercised a lot of options. He got some insane amount of option dollars. And the stuff that he actually had sold or had already sold, he got to cash out on. But he still had a decent amount. Some of the guys at Bear Stearns had $1 billion in stock that they hadn't yet sold. Now, there are rules when you're an insider, and you can't turn around and just dump, $1 billion worth of stock. So I would imagine eventually over time they would have cashed all of this in. But as of, the collapse of Bear in March 08 and the collapse of Lehman in September 08, they were on the route to selling the stock. So whatever was still in stock form lost most of its value. Whatever they had already cashed in, well, that's now, it's not easy supporting a villa in Tuscany and a house in North Palm Beach and another in Manhattan. There are costs that you have to do. It's expensive.
I understand that. So, and by all press accounts, Fuld walked away with at least $400 million.
At least, right. Plus whatever he was, spending and living on Not a bad gig for driving a 86-year-old business into obscurity.
I'd like to bankrupt a company if I can get paid $400 million to do it.
Hey, you know what? Even if you don't bankrupt a company, it's still not a bad gig.
Okay, now, Barry, we got to talk about, though, how this is allowed to happen. Because if I'm a shareholder, obviously I can't be happy about this situation. How are the boards set up so that the shareholders do not have as much say as the people running the company who have completely different incentives?
It's hidden in plain view. You essentially stop and think about mom and pop with their average portfolio. You know, if you're a client of Merrill Lynch or Morgan Stanley, you typically have a 15 or a 20 stock portfolio. And what that means is each stock has 8, 10, 12 directors. You do the math on that. 10 times 20 companies is 200 people plus the 200 people they're running against. You know, what individual has time to track 400 directors of the various companies? So it's out there and it's disclosed, but nobody but a handful of wonks really sees it. And the people who should be paying attention to it, who have the time, the expertise, the money, the incentive, are the – they actually have the ability to do this, but, you know, they would much rather – not get on the bad side of the investment houses, because the investment houses pay them, give them 401k business, give them IPOs, so they kind of vote the shares.
But let's break down the mechanics of it. Who selects the board? And what
the board
say
is elected by the shareholders. Now, there's a nomination process that typically happens. Sometimes it's the board, sometimes it's a committee. Very often the board is nominating themselves, and there's a process to run against them, but it's much more complex when you're an outsider. There have been some proposals to democratize this and make it a little less one-sided. You know, there are proxy battles and all sorts of things like that. The bottom line is it's an enormous incumbent advantage, even more so than running for Congress.
And why do they have an incentive to make sure that CEOs and the executives get such grotesque compensation at the cost of the shareholders? What's their incentive?
Well, they're just hooking up a bud. It's that simple. I've actually sat on corporate boards. Some of them are a lot of work. Some of them are not very, very much work. And you get paid, depending on the size of the company, you get a combination of cash and stock. Some of these guys are professional directors. They're on five or six boards. Each board pays $100,000, $150,000. With a slug of stock, if the company makes money, hey, it's a home run. And if the company goes belly up, it's not really your fault. It was a bad technology. It just the time was wrong. Everybody always has a million reasons why something went down. But, you know, you have to look at the management and how the company was handled.
All right. So now when we get to the bailout mess, right, so as we've explained on the show many times in the conversation we just had, the executives have all the incentive in the world to take as much risk as possible. And the shareholders can't even get a good rein on them because the board is in league with the executives rather than being in league with the shareholders. So this is a system that is set up to run amok.
The weird thing is that for a long time it operated, I don't want to say perfectly because it clearly wasn't, but it operated fairly credibly without a whole lot of silliness taking place. I think two things have happened over the past couple of decades that are fairly significant change the ground rules a little bit. And by the way, just as an aside, you will notice that all of the big partnerships, the Lazard Freres and the Brown Brother Harrimans and the firms that are pretty substantial in size, they didn't blow up. They didn't implode. And that's because of the corporate structure. If you're a corporation and you blow up, well, hey, it's the shareholders' loss. Oh, well. If you're a partnership and you blow up, it's a very different set of ramifications. A corporation is essentially a shield, and you can't go after insiders. The whole idea of a shareholder in a corporation is that whatever you have put up to buy those shares, that's the most you're risking. In a partnership, if you did what, let's say, Citigroup or Merrill Lynch or some of the other firms did and lose tens of billions of dollars, Well, the creditors don't just go after the partnership the way they would go after a corporation. They would also go after the assets of each individual partner. It's a joint and several liability, which means their house, their car, their Rolex, their boat, you know, their bank accounts, their retirement accounts, everything is at risk. So when you look at that structure, it's not a surprise that the shareholders got the short end of the stick and the partnerships exercised much better judgment when it came to taking risk.
I knew I was going to learn something today.
So that's not a coincidence. When you actually
let me explore that a little more, because I just want to be absolutely sure on it. So did almost all the partnerships like Lazard go unscathed? And
100%, not almost, not 99, not 98. All of the big Wall Street partnerships. And by the way, 40 years ago, Goldman Sachs and Merrill Lynch and Morgan Stanley, they were partnerships. It's only in the past couple of decades that they went public. But, you know, I want to make sure I'm making it clear the difference. If you're a corporate insider, if you're at, you know, Big Investment House, Inc., the most you can lose is whatever stock you own. You're not liable for any additional losses. That all falls to the corporate entity, and when those losses exceed the assets, when the corporate entity becomes insolvent, you declare bankruptcy and you walk away and it's all over. And the opposite is true in a partnership. In a partnership, if you're look at what happened with Arthur Andersen. If your partner does something really stupid and the damages, the losses exceed the value of the partnership, exceed whatever assets you have, the creditors keep coming after you until they've exhausted all the assets of the partnership itself and then each individual partner. And that is, not surprisingly, creates an incentive to take a little less risk, to be a little more intelligent about how speculative you're going to get. There's no incentive to let it all hang out.
So, in
a corporation, it's heads I win, tails you lose, or at least the way this most recent generation of Wall Street execs ran their firms. You know, most of these firms did fine for decades. It's just in the past 10 years they decided to blow themselves up.
We're talking to Barry Riddles. He is the author of Bailout Nation, and we'll put that up on theyoungturks.com so you can get that in our library. Barry, that leads to a natural consequence. That must mean that corporations, since they have this perverse incentive structure, need to be more tightly regulated. Because if you allow them to take crazy risks, they almost certainly will.
Well, what's sort of odd, and this is really, you know, I'd love to do a series of psychological interviews every year from 1980 to 2010 and see if you can actually find the inflection point. For the most part, and I'm the, you know, I've been so critical of Wall Street and so critical of Washington and what's so bizarre to me is the vast majority of people who work on Wall Street had nothing or very little to do with this. And the best example of that, AIG had 65,000 employees. 390 worked in AIG Financial Products, which was the derivative trading division that blew up the whole firm. And so that number is really extreme, under 400 versus 65,000. But when you look at these big firms, the Merrill Lynch's and the Bear Stearns and Lehman Brothers, it's 1 or 2% of the whole staff that was responsible for this. So the question, this is a long way to go to answer your question, but how can you modify the incentives so that the guys at the very periphery, the guys who are taking the most amount of risk, moving the most amount of money, engaging in the most speculative behavior, how could you modify their behavior so they don't do that? And some of the short answers are, well, if you're engaging in any form of speculation that has long-term possible trading consequences, if you're securitizing 30-year mortgages, well, you should get paid each quarter. There should be a substantial chunk of that payment held back so we know that what you're selling isn't going to blow up down the road.
So because we talk to a lot of Republicans and conservatives on this show who say, oh, no, the answer is to get the government out of the way of the business and to let the Wall Street guys regulate themselves because...
Hey, that worked out really well. That's a great idea. And you know what? You know what you want to do? If you want to let Wall Street regulate itself, here's what you do. Take a five-year-old kid and put a giant plate of chocolate chip cookies, a mound in front of him, and say, now you can only have half a cookie. I'll be back in 2 hours. And if you have more than half a cookie, well, I'm going to be upset. When you come back, what do you think you're going to be looking at? It's one of the silliest things. Let's also take it a step further. Not only are these industries not capable of self-regulation, but when you look at the nexus between Washington, D.C. and Wall Street, you know, we have an amendment that separates church and state. We really should have an amendment that separates finance and state. Every one of these companies that blew up on Wall Street did so because a key contributor was they went to D.C. and asked for a favor, got it, and then fell on that sword. So Citigroup had been lobbying to repeal Glass-Steagall for 12 years. I mean, there's a quote in the book that's from the late 80s. They've been pushing to repeal this. They finally got it repealed in 98, and then they promptly went out and took this freedom to do stuff that Wall Street does and blew themselves up with it. If you look at the Commodities Future Modernization Act, which created this special exemption for derivatives, and unlike every other financial instrument that should be on an exchange and the parties, counterparties have to be disclosed, and if there's an obligation to pay a sum in the future, you have to have a reserve of capital against that potential obligation. There are all these standard things that make sure that, you know, if you buy a stock, you actually get that stock. If you buy an insurance policy, when someone dies, the insurance company has the ability to write a check and make good on it. We carved out this exemption for derivatives. It was done by a guy named Phil Gramm, senator out of Texas, on behalf of his wife, Wendy Gramm, who was on the board of directors of Enron. It turned out that there was another group lobbying for this, a small little outfit called AIG. Now, Enron blew up due to accounting fraud. Derivatives didn't help bring them down. But there's no doubt that AIG, which had written $3 trillion, that's with a T, $3 trillion worth of options and had taken a mere 10 basis points against it, hey, listen, $3 billion a year is not chicken feed. That's one-tenth of 1% of $3 trillion. But stop and think about how irresponsibly reckless that is. You have to make sure that every side of $3 trillion in derivatives are matched perfectly, because if they're not matched perfectly in one something, it's like being a bookie. You know, if you bet on the Jets or the Colts, it doesn't matter as long as there are enough people betting on the other way so that whoever wins, the bookie doesn't lose. These guys didn't really do that. So when housing started to fall and there were problems with payments of credit default swaps, which were guarantees on companies like Lehman and Bear Stearns, they basically bet on the Jets, and when the Colts won, they were shellacked. And it's just a horrifically irresponsible way to run a business, and there was zero oversight. Nobody was looking at them saying, due to this Commodities Future Modernization Act, saying, hey, you guys really have a lot of leverage and a lot of risk. You need to reserve for this, and if you can't reserve for this, well, then we're going to have to step in. That didn't take place. And again, that was something they had requested. And, you know, the big five, I could give you a million examples. I'll give you one last example. The five biggest investment houses, Morgan Stanley, Goldman Sachs, Merrill Lynch, Lehman Brothers, and Bear Stearns, in 2004 went to the SEC and said, you guys have this rule called the net capitalization rule, and it only allows us to take our capital and trade it at 12 times the amount of money we have. So if we have $1 billion, we can only go out and buy $12 billion worth of assets with that. That 12 to 1 is really constraining, because sometimes we go a little over. We need a little fudge room in case we spend more than we have. And as soon as they, by the way, the irony is they called it the Bear Stearns exemption, because it was anyone who was Bear Stearns size, $5 billion in assets or greater, was exempt. And it was really an exemption for just these five companies. And they promptly proceeded not to go 12.5 or 13 to 1, but 25, 35, 40 to 1. Now, at 12-1, you got a little room for error, but not a whole lot. You know, if something drops 3 or 4% at 12-1, you still have some capital left. At 40-1, something drops 2.5%, you're completely wiped out. And so the great irony is all five of those firms that requested this exemption either no longer exist, like Bear or Lehman's or Merrill, or no longer exist as an investment house. Goldman and Morgan Stanley had to turn themselves into banks in order to be able to go to the Fed and borrow money very cheaply.
All right.
So all these companies get special favor. It's not so much that there is regulation or wasn't regulation. There are a lot of examples of them asking for a favor, getting it, and using that favor to blow themselves up.
All right. Barry, I could talk to you for hours. I got to bring you on another day. The book is called Bailout Nation. Very good insights in there into what went wrong. We really appreciate you joining us.
My pleasure. I think it's the only approach that takes, you know, the holistic view and tries to look at everything from a corporate, a legislative, a central bank perspective and figure out how the hell did this mess happen.
All right. Bailout Nation. Thank you.